Well, turn with me to the book of Galatians. We're going to be in Galatians chapter 3. We're going to be looking at verses 15 through 22 this morning. And as we do, if you had the chance to read these verses ahead of time, hopefully you prayed for me. And you said, wow, this is not easy. So hopefully the Holy Spirit speaks this morning. These are challenging passages, but I believe the Lord has an important truth for us to understand this morning. Now, what we're going to talk about this morning is the purpose of the law, the purpose of rules. Why did God give rules? That's a question my kids ask often. I don't know about your children, but we have rules in our household. I'm sure you have rules in your household. Rules are good. They instill order and direction. Without rules, you have absolute chaos and anarchy. But many times, our children ask, why, right? Why the rules? And for some reason, they don't like the response, because I said so, right? They're not big fans of that. But they're asking the question, why are the rules? They're trying to understand what is the purpose of these. And the reason is because those rules wage war against their desires and against their intentions. Well, the people of Galatia that Paul is writing to, they are asking that question as well, because Paul has been telling them throughout this letter that the law does not save. If you haven't picked that up yet, that's one of his primary themes. The law does not save. The Judaizers who were trying to influence the Galatians, they were telling them, it's great that you love Jesus. It's great that you've trusted in Jesus. But if you really want to honor God, then you must obey the law, specifically circumcision and the ceremonial law. The Jews were saying, yes, Gentiles, you must obey the law. And Paul has been writing, and he has been saying that you are justified, you are made right before God, not by what you do in obedience, but through Christ, what Christ has done through his obedience. And this is such a significant theological truth for us to understand. You see, religion says, I need to do something to be acceptable to God. The gospel says that because of what Jesus has done, he has made us acceptable before God. They are radically different. And so, because Paul has been saying following the law is not what saves you, then the obvious question is, why the law? Why then would God give the law? If the law and our obedience to the law is not what saves us, but rather faith in Christ through God's grace is what saves us, then why do we have the law? And Paul is not going to answer completely. You have to go through many different passages to understand a full and complete understanding of the law and its purpose for New Testament Christians. But what he is going to answer this morning specifically is what the law is in relation to salvation. Why did God give the law? And we see that in verse 19. Look at chapter 3, verse 19. You see what he says there. Why then the law? Paul is going to answer that question. But in doing so, he's also going to compare and contrast the promise of God and the law of God, and he's going to show how they are not at odds with one another, but rather how they complement one another, but how only one has the power to save. And so let's look at that together in Galatians chapter 3, beginning in verse 15. This is the word of God. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one. And to your offspring, and to your offspring, who is Christ. This is what I mean. the law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions, until the offspring should come to whom the promise has been made, and it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the Scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to this passage, Lord, upon first reading, it is challenging for us to understand. We pray, God, this morning that you would bring clarity. We pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would bring application as well. Father, that we would understand and know, God, that the promise of your grace is so far superior. And yet, God, we constantly want to return to legalism and the law. Not that the law is bad in any way, Father, but the realization that we are absolutely incapable of fulfilling it. And so, Lord, we give you thanks this morning for the fact that Jesus has fulfilled what we never could and has given us his righteousness in exchange for our sin. We pray, God, that you would teach us now from your word and change us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, the big idea of this passage is that Paul is comparing and contrasting the promise of God, or the grace of God, with the law of God and the works that we may try to do to appease God. That's the big idea and the big concept. And in the first section, he's going to give the reason the promise or the grace of God can save us. He's going to show us how the promise of God and the grace of God is what our hope should be in, because it is superior and it can save us, as opposed to the law of God, which he'll tell us in a moment why God gave the law, but in doing so, he'll tell us the law cannot, will not save. So let's look first at the reason the promise or the grace of God can save us. And the first thing that Paul gives is an illustration. And in that illustration, he illustrates that the promise of God can never be broken. Verse 15. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. Now, Paul is here giving an illustration of what he has been trying to demonstrate and trying to prove. It's interesting here that he calls them brothers. Now, you will recall that in the beginning of Galatians, he called them, "You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you," right? Very strong language. He is frustrated. He is angry, maybe even, at the fact that they are now trusting in the law instead of trusting in God's grace. But here, he kind of tones things down, and he brings it back to the fact that he calls them brothers. The fact is that he cares for them deeply, and it's out of his genuine care for them that he wants them to understand the promise of God. And he gives this human example. And in this human example, he gives the example of a covenant, or maybe even better, a will. And when you write out your will and you declare what it is that you want to happen, and a lawyer or somebody ratifies that, after you pass away, that will cannot be altered. It cannot be changed. In our society, it requires for the person to actually, you know, you can change your will all the way up until the point that you pass away. But once you pass away, your will cannot be altered. There's been cases where people have tried to, you know, family members have tried to get the will altered, but the court has always stood for the fact, but no, this was the intention of the person. This is how the law will stand, the will will stand. But in Greek and in Jewish culture, there was actually a way for a will to be written where it could not be altered, even as the person was alive. And this is a covenant that Paul is illustrating. And he's saying, listen, even in a human way, when a covenant is made, when a promise is made, when a will or a testament is given, it cannot be altered. And what Paul is doing is he is arguing from the lesser to the greater. And he's saying the lesser is human commitment. And if humans can keep their commitment, if humans can keep their promise, then how much more can we rely and trust in the promise, in the covenant of God? God is, his covenant is eternal, everlasting, and sure. That's what Paul is trying to get across. Whereas the law, we will see, is temporary and serves a purpose, God's covenant is forever. Now, what was God's covenant? Well, he has referred to it before. It is the covenant that God made with Abraham in Genesis. In Genesis chapter 12 and chapter 17, he refers to it in verse 16. Look at verse 16. Now, the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. Now, for us to understand what Paul's really getting at, we have to kind of understand the covenant that God made with Abram or with Abraham. And so we look back at Genesis chapter 12. If you have your Bible, you can turn back there with me. Genesis chapter 12, and specifically verses 2 and 3. He says this, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, so that you will be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And so God makes a promise. Now, you'll notice that this is just a promise from God to Abraham with no requirements from Abraham. He doesn't say, if you do this, Abraham, then I will do this. He simply says, I will bless you. I will, I will, I will. That's the theme of the covenant, of the promise. God makes a promise. And he promises to give them a land. He promises to give them a name. And he promises to give them a blessing. Now, this covenant, we see again in Genesis 15. Turn to Genesis 15, beginning of verse 5. We see this. Again, God continues this covenant. He says, and he brought him outside, and he said to him, look towards heaven. The number of the stars, if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And then look at verse 6. And he believed the Lord. And he, God, counted it to him, Abraham, as righteousness. You see, this is the faith that is exercised that signifies the belief in this promise, the belief in this covenant. And this is what Paul is going back to say, this is the promise. This is God's grace. This is the foundation for salvation. Then the promise is ratified. And this is where it gets really interesting. Look at Genesis, go to verse 8. And I'm going to read a couple different verses there. But look at verse 8. And to sign this covenant, this is what happened. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? And God said to him, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. Verse 10, and he brought him all of these. He cut them in half, and he laid each half over against the other. And so what happened is he takes these animals, he cuts them in half, and he puts them on two sides. And this was how a covenant, it was signed. Now, I'm grateful that we just get to sign our, right when I bought my house, I just got to sign my signature until my hand cramped. But this is how they signed the covenant. And it was to say, if either party breaks this covenant, this is what shall happen to them. They shall be cut in half. They shall be killed. Their blood will be on the line of this covenant. That's what's taking place here. But what would happen is that both parties would walk through these animals signifying this covenant. But look at verse 12. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram. And behold, dreadful and great darkness fell upon him. And so God causes Abram to fall asleep. And we find out in verse 17 why. Look at verse 17. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham. Now, what's interesting here is that in an Old Testament covenant, normally what would happen is that both parties would walk through these animals signifying one covenant to one another. But in this case, Abram is asleep because God is saying, I will make a covenant, but Abram, it will not be dependent upon your faithfulness because you will never be faithful. But it will be dependent upon my faithfulness. God makes a covenant with Abraham, but he makes a covenant really with himself. And he says, by my grace, by my mercy, I will cause these things to happen for my name. This is the reason that we can rest in the promise of God, because it is not dependent upon our faithfulness, but rather is dependent upon God's faithfulness and God's grace. Friends, you need to understand that you will never be able to satisfy the law. And if the law is your measure of salvation, you will try and try and fail. But if your measure is God's promise of grace, you will stop trying. Instead, you will rest in his promises. And as you will rest in his promises, and as you abide in him, he will give you a new heart, which will allow you to then walk in his righteousness and in his grace and in his mercy, not because of your effort, but because of God's faithfulness. You see, this is what Paul's trying to get across, that if you're resting in your obedience or your ability or your goodness, your righteousness, you are under the law. And the law said, thou shalt, right? When God brought the law, it was thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt. If you do this, you'll be blessed. If you do not do this, you'll be cursed. But the promise is all about, I will, I will, I will. The foundation is God's grace. Therefore, it can never be broken. And so we can rest in it, trust in it, believe in it, because it's not based upon our faithfulness. It's based upon His faithfulness. That song we sang was amazing to be reminded. Yes, my sins are many, but Your mercy, Your grace is more. And His mercy is the foundation of this promise. But we see even more than that as verse 16 continues. This promise is dependent upon Christ. The reason we know this promise can save us is because this promise is dependent upon Christ. That's what he's saying in verse 16. He says, now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, plural, referring to many, but referring to one. And to your offspring, who is Christ. Now, Paul is interpreting Scripture for them and for us. He is going back to an Old Testament passage, and he is exegeting it for us by the illumination or by the guiding of the Holy Spirit. And here God is showing him that this offspring that is referred to in this covenant with Abraham is not just referring to all of Abraham's children, but it is referring to a single offspring who will come, who will be faithful, who will satisfy the law, who will give his life. It is Jesus Christ that Paul is referring to here, that Christ would become our sin and would give us his righteousness. You see, the law can never save because the law is dependent upon our righteousness. And friends, we have failed. We have fallen short of God's glory. But Jesus has not failed. He never failed. And so Paul is trying to connect these dots for the Galatians to help them to understand that we can rest and trust in the promise of God because it is not dependent upon us, but rather it is dependent upon Christ. You see, so many people think that if I become righteous, if I do good things, if I can do enough, then maybe God will accept me. But see, the gospel says, come to Jesus. Come broken. Come acknowledge that you're a sinner. And God, by His grace, will transform you, will rescue you, will save you. You see, one is religion. I will do what I can to earn God's favor. The other is the good news of the gospel, that you could never do enough. And so God, by His mercy and His grace, made a way through Jesus that you and I could never make. And so the promise is not dependent upon us. It's dependent upon the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. And so we can rejoice because it is dependent upon Him. And finally, we can trust in this promise because of the one who gives it. Because this promise is given by God. Look at verse 17. Paul says, this is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God so as to make the promise void. Now, again, what Paul is talking about is two covenants. He's talking about the covenant of promise and the covenant of law. And what the Judaizers were teaching was that, well, yes, maybe God at one time responded to His people through promise and grace and mercy. Now, since He has given the law, He now responds through the law, and we must be obedient to the law. They were saying that God revealed in a greater way at Mount Sinai how we are to be saved. And Paul is saying, no, the opposite is true. The covenant that God made with the law that came did not nullify the covenant that God had originally made. So he's going to say the law served a different purpose, not the purpose to save. You have to look back at Abraham to understand the promise. That's what he's trying to point them back to. He says, the law, which came 430 years afterwards, this most likely refers to the time that Israel was in captivity. Because if you take all of the time between Abraham and between Mount Sinai, it's like 600 and some years. And so most commentators think that this refers to the time that, from the time that the nation of Israel through Jacob went down into captivity in Egypt. From that 430 years afterward, the law was given on Mount Sinai to Moses. But that law does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God so as to make that promise void. He says, the law does not replace grace. The law had a different purpose. Its purpose was never to save. It was never to bring people to salvation. It had a different purpose, which Paul is going to tell us in a minute. Verse 18, for if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. You see, what Paul is saying again is that the law and the promise are not equal ways to God. We've talked about this before, right? The belief that people have that if I have a little bit of faith, and if I have a little bit of good works, that in the end, that's going to get me into heaven. But Paul has shown us over and over again that these two things are at odds with one another as far as a way to salvation. They complement one another when you understand them, but if you believe that they both lead to God, they will clash with one another because one is based on your obedience. The other is based on the obedience of Christ. One is based on your effort. The law is based on your effort. The other is based and dependent upon the absolute acknowledgement that you cannot save yourself. You see how these two are at odds with one another? How they cannot both lead to salvation and yet are contemporary Christianity, our modern culture, believes this very lie. That maybe, yes, I'm saved in the beginning by faith, but it really is about my effort and my work and my goodness and my righteousness. No, it is all about God's grace. That's what Paul is trying to bring us back to. It is by the promise. God gave the promise. God gave it to Abraham by a promise. He's talking about the inheritance, the blessing. The blessing did not come by obedience. The blessing came by promise. It is grace that would save his people, and the law did not nullify that. You see, God's grace is the center of the Christian life. It is the reality that we must come back to over and over and over again. Because I don't know about you, but my tendency is to drift back into the law. My tendency is to drift back into a measurable way that I can say, I'm a pretty good guy. I'm a pretty good person. And others, they're not as good as I am. Right? That's our tendency. Our tendency is to maybe come to faith in Christ by grace, but then drift into our obedience and the law. Paul is here reminding us that grace is the foundation of the Christian life. That we must always come back to grace, that we must always come back to the cross. That we must always come back to the understanding that we could not save ourselves, but that God alone could save us. This is the center of the Christian life. And so our greatest responsibility is to abide in Christ and to be dependent upon Christ. You see, when grace is the center, when grace is the foundation, we stop striving and working and trying. It doesn't mean we don't work, but it means we stop trying in our effort to please God and we begin to abide in Christ. And friends, you'll be amazed. As you abide in Christ, that God will transform your life, transform your heart, that you'll begin to desire to walk in righteousness and obedience, not because it earns any favor with God. You are already righteous in His sight. You are adopted into His family. You belong to Him. That you on your best day, God will not love you any less. And on your worst day, God will not love you any less. He loves you because of His grace and His mercy. And understanding that gives you the freedom then to walk in righteousness. But we have a tendency to come back to dependency on ourselves and not on Christ. And so are you dependent upon Christ? Are you abiding in Jesus? Or are you still trying to work and earn His love and His favor? So we see here that the promise of God is superior. The law does not nullify the promise. The promise is the foundation of our salvation. It is by grace alone, by Christ alone, in Christ alone, through faith alone. That is the way of salvation. So why the law? Why did God give the law? Well, here he turns in verse 19 to the reason the law cannot save us. The reason the law or works that we attempt to do cannot save us. And the first thing he shows us is that the law lacks the purpose to save. The law was never intended to save. It was never meant to be salvation. It was meant to point us to our need for salvation. You see, this is very important that you understand. The reason God gave the law, Paul says, was never to save us. It was never to work hard to be saved. It was always to point us to the fact that we needed a Savior and to point us to the true Savior. So what is the purpose of the law if not to save us, if not to earn favor with God? Well, Paul says, verse 19, why then the law? It was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made, and it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, this is a little convoluted and challenging to understand, but let me try to break it down and try to clarify it as much as possible. Paul says, why do we have the law? And his answer is, it was added because of transgressions. It was added because of sin. Now, the first thing is to notice is the word added. It was added. Notice that Paul says it did not replace. The law did not replace the promise. It was added. And this Greek word means to come alongside of. Not in addition to, but to come alongside of. The law and the promise serve two very different purposes. And here Paul is telling us what the purpose is, because of transgressions, because of sin. The law, what is the purpose of the law? Why then the law? It was added because of sin. Now, what does Paul mean by this? Well, there's two possible meanings to this. The first is he could mean that God gave the law to restrain sin. And that the law serves that purpose, does it not? I mean, the very fact that we have laws that say do not murder you know, causes you to think twice when, you know, you're angry at your coworker and you say, all right, I do not want to end up in prison for the rest of my life, or, you know, have my life taken. So the law does restrain sin. And we see throughout the rest of the Bible, there are places where that is clearly a purpose of the law. But what Paul, I think, is referring to here is more than just restraining sin, but rather God has given the law to expose sin. You see, the law, and when we rightly look at God's law, and just take, for instance, the Ten Commandments, which is the summary of God's law, or even smaller than that, take Jesus' summary of the law. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. As you see how you fall short of that, it exposes your sin, and it exposes your need for a Savior. You see, the law exposes our sin, does it not? Tell a child, don't touch that. Now they know the law. Their heart says, man, I want to touch that. Does it not? Right? Maybe I'll touch when nobody's looking. What is it about that, right? The law exposes our rebellion against God. As soon as somebody tells me what I cannot do, well, then I'm going to tell them I'm going to do that. It exposes our rebellion. It exposes, no God is going to tell me what I'm going to do. Nobody's going to shape my life. Nobody's going to command me. I will say what is right for me. Does that not sound like our culture today? And the reason that our culture wants to strip away all of God's laws is because those laws expose their sin. And they don't want their sin exposed. They don't want anybody telling them what's right or wrong. They want to make that up themselves. In fact, I just saw recently that Oxford has added the word of this year is post-truth. But this is the land we live in. This is the world we live in, a post-truth world. And it basically says that no longer are truth norms the things that people look to, but rather their feelings or how they feel about things to express what is right and what is wrong. And why? Because the law exposes our sin. You see, as we look at the law, just read the Ten Commandments, it screams, you cannot do this. You are a sinner by nature, by choice, by will, by heart. And so we push away the law and we say, I will not listen to what God says, or we fall on our face in repentance, in understanding our desperate need for a Savior. You see, Paul says here, and he'll say again in other places, the law is a mirror. And when you look at that mirror, it doesn't have the power to save you, but it does have the power to show you you need to be saved. It does have the power to show you where you fall short of the glory of God. It's like when you walk, you know, and you walk in the morning and you see yourself in the mirror and you go, whoa, all right, I need to fix that, right? There's some serious issues going on there. I need to fix that. The law tells us you need to be fixed. But you know what? The law has no power to fix you. The law can't change your heart. It can't change your desires. That's what Paul is saying here. The law cannot save. It was not intended to save. It was intended to walk alongside the promise and to point you to the promise, to say, you need a Savior, and here is the Savior. His name is Jesus Christ. This is the point that Paul is trying to make, that we must call sin, sin. You see, our culture is constantly trying to move away from calling anything sin or calling anything, acknowledging any moral normality or any moral norms. And we as the church, we must stand upon God's truth in every way, shape, and form. Because until people understand the bad news, they can never understand the good news. And as long as somebody believes, I can live any way I want, I can be a good person in my own mind, in my own heart, I can, fill in the blank that I'm okay, they'll never understand their need for a Savior. And so God gave the law, and the law just exposes us. It just lays us bare before God, recognizing our total and complete inability. That was the reason for the law. It was to point us to our need. And we see here also that the law was temporary. It wasn't meant to be forever. It's inferior to the promise because it was temporary. Look at verse 19. He says, it was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come to whom the promise has been made. You see, the law had a beginning and has an end. It began on Mount Sinai. God gave the law. Now, the moral truth of the law is eternal. But the law that God gave his people at Sinai, the rules, the regulations, the restrictions, the sacrifices especially, all of those things had a starting point, and that was at Mount Sinai. But they also had a conclusion, and that was at Calvary. You see, when Jesus became our sin upon the cross, he made a way to God that was not through obedience to the law, but was through faith in his finished work. And one of the ways that that was demonstrated was that the curtain in the temple was ripped in two, showing that there is now access to God directly, that there was no need for a mediator, that there was no need for a priest any longer to offer sacrifices. Now you realize throughout the whole Old Testament that people would come to a priest, that that priest would lay their hands on an animal, that that animal would be sacrificed, and that all of that was to point to the final sacrifice of Jesus Christ. But after Jesus gave his life, there was no longer a need for sacrifice because Jesus was that sacrifice. You see, the promise came through Christ. And so the law was temporal. Now, what Paul's not saying, he's not saying the law serves no purpose in the life of a believer. The law is good. The law is holy. The problem is us. And here Paul is dealing with the fact that we cannot satisfy the law. And so God made a way through Christ. The rest of verse 19 and 20 show again that the law is inferior to the promise because the law has a need for a mediator. The reason the law can't save us is because the law required a mediator. Now, these are very challenging verses in verses 19 and 20 because verse 20 may possibly be one of the most complicated, debated passages or in all the New Testament. But I'll tell you through my study what I think Paul's saying here. He says, first of all, now it was put in place through angels by an intermediator. So he makes a point to say the law was given and there had to be an intermediator between man and God. You remember that? That's Moses, right? When God gave the law, Moses was the only one that was receiving the law, and God and Moses then would give the law to the people. In fact, when God gave the law, the people were warned if they even touched the mountain that God was on, they would die. That's how serious it was, and that God had there had to be a mediator between, because there was a showing by giving the law, you cannot approach me on your own. But through Christ, there is no intermediary. Christ is our intermediary. He himself is the one who has given us access to God. And so Paul is saying here that it no longer is that needed. And that's what he means in verse 20. He says, now an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Here's what I think he's saying. A covenant requires two people. It requires there to be two people and an intermediary in between those two people. But Paul is saying here that there is no mediator. God is one. There is now direct access to God, and that God is the one who holds his covenant and keeps his promise. The promise of God is completely dependent upon him and his faithfulness. Friends, that is the hope for our salvation. Not in our ability to keep God's commandments, but in the truth of Jesus Christ and the fact that he did keep the commandments. And then in the final two verses, what Paul answers here is he reveals our inability to keep that law and God, and Christ's ability to keep it. So the final thing we see here, verse 21 and 22, is that the law can never be satisfied by us. Look at verse 21 and 22. Paul says, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if the law had been given, for if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. So the natural question that we might ask is, well then is the law contrary to grace? How can these two exist together? And Paul answers in the strongest negative, certainly not. The law is not contrary to the promises of God. They serve different purposes. And he says here, if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. He says, if a law, this is a hypothetical he gets, he says, if a law could be given that could give life, and if you could obey it perfectly, then you could have life through the law. This is what we've been saying before, that if you and I could obey all of God's law, it would be the life that God desired, and we would be perfect, right? If we could obey, if we could love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, and do that perfectly all the time without fail, that would bring life. But the very fact that we violate God's law one time brings about the condemnation, the just condemnation of the law. And so Paul says here, the law cannot save. Look at verse 22. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. What is he saying here? But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin. Again, he's going back to saying the law, its purpose was to show us our need for a Savior. You see, when the scripture imprisoned everything in sin, it revealed to us that we were trapped in sin. Is that not what happens? As you read the scripture, you begin to understand how far short you fall from the glory of God. And all that you try, all that your effort, all that you try to do to get out of sin does not rescue you, does not save you. In fact, sometimes it just drives you farther and deeper into sin. And Paul uses an example here that we are imprisoned. And this is the reality of sin. Sin is a prison that you are locked into apart from Christ. And you cannot get out. No matter how much you try, no matter what your effort is, you are stuck. But the beauty of the gospel is that what Jesus is saying is that the promise by faith in Christ released you from that prison. Not because you earned it, Not because you deserved it, not because you served and got time off for good behavior, but because of what Jesus Christ has done for you on your behalf. You see, Paul first has to give the bad news. You're trapped in a prison by your sin. But then he gives the good news. Look what he says. So that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. The promise here refers to the salvation, to the blessing. By faith in Jesus Christ, this again is the way that we receive this promise, is through belief and trust and faith in Jesus Christ, might be given. This shows us that this is not something we earn. You remember the verse I read a few weeks ago? For the wages of sin is death. Wages are something we earn or deserve. What we earn for our sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You see, salvation is a gift. And here Paul says it again, that might be given. It's a gift that must be received. You can't earn it. You don't deserve it. But by God's grace, you can receive it. As you acknowledge yourself a sinner, as you place your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, to those who believe. It's not based upon where you were, what kind of family you had. It wasn't based upon how good or how not good you are. It's based upon how you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And friends, that's good news. That's good news for every single person in here. That if you place your faith and your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you can be saved. Not because of what you have done, but because of what he has done on your behalf. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So what are you trusting in? Are you trusting in your obedience? Are you trusting in your ability? Are you trusting in your faithfulness to the law? Or are you trusting and resting in Jesus Christ alone? Paul is contrasting here the law and the promise, and he's saying the law will never save. The promise, God's grace, is what shows us, is what gives us salvation. The law shows us our need, but the grace of God gives us salvation. And that promise is revealed through Jesus Christ. And just as Abraham believed the promise and was saved, so too, the only way we can enter God's kingdom is through faith in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that your law, your word, your truth is good. We also acknowledge, Lord, and recognize our rebellion against it. That our natural heart rejects and rebels against truth because we don't want to acknowledge our need. But Father, we thank you that by your grace and by your mercy, that many in here have been brought to an understanding of their dependence and their need for Jesus Christ for salvation. Father, I pray for those that are in here this morning, Lord, that have yet to do that, that are trusting in something else, or trusting in their own ability, or maybe they just don't believe any of it at all. They don't believe that you even exist. And Father, I pray that this morning that you, through your Holy Spirit, would bring a weight upon their heart, that they would feel that entrapment to sin, that they would feel and bear the weight of the law upon their lives, recognizing their need for a Savior. And I pray, God, that you would help them to know and understand that there is no other name by which men are saved and women are saved but through Jesus Christ alone. And so, Father, we thank you that you did something we could never do, that you made us right and righteous through the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's in his name we give thanks. It's in his name that we pray. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.